don't really have a question. I would just like to thank you for coming today. I would just like to thank you for coming today, and I would like to point out to Auburn University students that this is a place of education, this is the place of ideas, and I'd like to thank this man for challenging the university who canceled him coming here. I'd like to thank the attorney who won the case. I'd like to thank the guy who brought him here. It doesn't matter whether or not I agree with this man or disagree with him, but students are supposed to go to colleges, are supposed to go to institutions of learning to be challenged. And thank you very much for challenging.
It did seem like.
You have to be quiet. Please, the audience, be quiet.
Experience in your life or time in your life that made you take up these views or help them increase your life?
Yeah, I've been asked this question a number of times. How did you become this way? And I think I was this way in the womb. There was no single moment that made me an identitarian. I think I was always this way, but at the same time, my life is a process of becoming, and it's a process of experience. There was a time when I was a leftist. There was a time that I was a libertarian. I actually would say, for people who are in the alt-right, who are over 30, the kind of Gen Xers, I think we actually all went through this process. Almost all of us went through a libertarian process. Some of us went to the left, with the conservatism, and so on. I think one remarkable thing is that a lot of millennials are just going straight to the dope. But they don't seem to have to pass through any libertarianism or something. For a number of different reasons. A, the world has become more intense, and B, so much is available on social media and the internet that they just become alt-right in their 20. It's a really amazing thing.
Where's my backpack?
Long question. Listening to political theology on the way here, I see a bit of a tautology in your ideology about what race is. You speak about race as being constantly evolving.
Correct.
From brotherly wars, we must evolve into who we will become.
Right.
But I also know that from your point of view, race is important. Race is real. Race is the basis of identity. If race is the basis of identity, and identity is shifting, race is shifting, I find myself, I ask this question in good faith. I see a bit of a tautology. If I can harken back to one of your favorite movies, The Matrix. Cypher swallows the red pill, truth, but then decides to be reinstalled. He's a traitor of sorts. So the question is, you want us to become who we are. You know, are not necessarily about preserving the white race as it exists, pink slime and capitalism. Start something new. That makes me think that your identity is somewhat grounded in choice, that we can become who we are. We have to make that choice.
Yes.
But if race is the basis of identity, but identity is also grounded in choice, I find myself at a logical impasse. I'm an American. I do not know my heritage. I'm sure I'm European. But I make my choices, and my choices determine my identity. Can you, I ask in good faith, try to explain that tautology?
Yes. Very good question. Let me back up. What this young man is saying is that race isn't just a being, it is a becoming. And what we mean by that is that race is it's a product of evolution, it is inherently changing. The choices you make are going to change who we are. I think so many of the social factors in the 21st century have had genetic consequences. How many people of my generation have no children? How many people who are my age, and I'm about to be 39, just in case you're curious, are living alone or with roommates in some apartment in Brooklyn? A lot of us. Well, we have made that choice, whether it's conscious or thought through or not, and that choice will have genetic consequences in the sense that what makes us as a species or subspecies is not going to continue. and what makes those people who have children, who form families, they are going to ultimately win. No doubt. We are a willing being. We aren't, I agree that the human being is an animal in the sense that we have animal urges, that we're a product of evolution. But we're a willing being. We create the world in our image. So race is not just a sense of like, we want to conserve some product of evolution for eternity. We want to will something greater. I don't want to will white people as we are today. Because white people as we are today, we define this world that is leading towards our death and our degeneration and our humiliation. I want to will something higher. So I am an idealist. I'm a racial idealist. I'm not a race realist. A race realist would accept everything as it is. A racial idealist wants to create a new world with a new outcome. So no, I don't think we can remove will from the equation of evolution. We reached a certain kind of singularity at some point where pure natural selection is not determining what our species actually is. Very few people in the white race are dying of starvation or so on. We're dying of heart disease because we're obese. We need to understand the power of our will to change our being. I mean, I hope that answers the highly philosophical question. All right, let's have more like crazy nuts ball questions. Those are my fun. So, no more philosophy majors.
My question is, so I grew up with a very strong sense of racial identity. My mother is Japanese, and I spent a lot of time with my Japanese family. Mm-hmm. And I didn't start to kind of come around to my father's English. Mm-hmm. I didn't start to come around to my white identity until maybe a few years ago. So my question is, how do you get people that are white, that have no sense of racial identity whatsoever, they never had a basis for any kind of identity at all, to kind of accept the ideals of the alt-right and to accept and even begin to like investigate their own history and their past and ancestry to find
identity? I don't have to convince them of anything. The fact is, I think we've all gone through a process of searching. I think that most good people have a sense of emptiness in the modern world, and they're searching for something deeper. They'll often find it in kind of nutso things like New Age philosophy or kind of, you know, trans religiosity or even trans racialism, where they'll embrace the destiny of another race as their own. How many, I don't know, I would assume Auburn is like almost every other university. How many crazy, you know, professors do you have who wrap themselves in the Palestinian flag? Who are white or Jewish, and they embrace that almost more than who they are. I think we're all in search of something because we're all experiencing this nihilistic world of modernity.
All right, for those of you who don't know, I'm a college football guy, that was me. And I'm actually up here to concede your point. I think you are right when you say that meaning in your life doesn't come from football or our culture or from going to Coyotes and getting drunk off your ass or anything like that. But I think you're
wrong. That has some meaning in it.
But I think you're wrong when you say that your identity and your meaning comes from your race. Because the fact of the matter is, each and every one of you in this room is created in the image of God. That in the end of the time, there will be neither slave nor free, no Jew nor Gentile, male or female.
You bet, Sam!
Jesus wasn't European.
I can answer that question. I would say that this yes, Jesus was not European. But I would say that this belief system, this belief system that you embrace is truly a product of centuries of European Christianity. It's centuries of religion that was truly informed by us. And it was informed by actually things that were much older and much deeper than the Christian faith, which was brought to the European peoples. They had a culture before Christianity. They were Europeans, they were Germans, they were Goths, they were Franks before they were Christians. And to simply wipe out that history in the name of something Paul said, I think is just to lose sight of the reality. I would also say there is this danger of Christianity for it to become liberalism with smells and bells, or liberalism with biblical quotes. And so the essence of Christianity, as you say it, is that you're neither man nor woman, Greek nor Jew, and so on. That is 21st century liberalism. And I think you should be a little bit skeptical when this supposed tradition that you embrace is identical to what is embraced by corporate HR departments. Let's just put it that way.
I certainly am still a man. You were still a woman.
Okay.
He's still black. We're all people.
Like, well, that was actually kind of funny.
We're still people. We are created in the image of God, and we were put on this earth to do good things. And you might, I know you want to create a perfect world, and you want to create a better world, and you want to transform the world for the better. But I'm just up here to inform you that that transformation occurred 2017 years ago on the hill on Calvary, and that we just celebrated that this past weekend. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Hey, good evening. How are you?
I'm doing well.
I have a two-part question. The first part is going to be first, and then there's a second part. I just want to let you know. Two parts, that means it's going to be two.
Do the second part first, please.
So the first part is, tonight you came up here and you had a lot of different things to say. I'm an undergraduate myself. You challenged a lot of perspectives and I sat there politely and I listened to you. But you didn't quote one fact. There was no figure in what you said. No, I mean this very nicely. And like I said, I listened to you, but you couldn't cite something. You cited feelings and emotions. And as you criticized the liberalism that is so much emotion, you stood up there tonight and said emotion. You said the world is a worse place, and don't you feel like that, white people? But I can say some facts to you. Literacy rate is the highest it's ever been in global history. People who die of war is the lowest it's ever been in history. Infant mortality is the lowest it's been in history. Women who die in childbirth is lowest in history. Is this diversity, is this globalization?
What do you think that's a product of?
I think that's a product of globalization.
Diversity? Did diversity create that? But look, all right, I don't know how to begin here. This idea that I want to throw facts at you all or quote something, I just find that a little bit lame, to be honest. I'm going to speak truthfully. And look, in terms of actual facts, suicide rates among whites are increasing. Suicide rates among whites are at an epidemic levels, along with drug use, along with some related factors like joblessness, sleeping more, spending their life on Netflix. The idea that you have this kind of like progressive linear history just keeps getting better, folks. It just keeps getting better. That just is kind of nonsense. And we could throw facts at each other all day long, but at the end of the day, a fact only has meaning because of the perspective looking on it. And so there is no fact. There is no fact that you can cite that's going to destroy identity or make it irrelevant. I mean, facts, let's be honest, are often used to marshal arguments. So I don't know what to say. I mean, facts are lame. I want to talk about stuff that really matters and that inspires people.
All right. Well, thank you. And the last question I have is, do you like fishnets?
What?
Do you like fishnets?
No.
You don't like fishnets?
No. Speak quiet and listen to the questioners.
Yeah, okay. How are you, Mr. Spitzer?
Doing well.
My name is Cameron Martinez. I'm black and Hispanic. I'm Cuban. I hadn't heard of you before this event, but I came against the ideals that you were speaking of today. I'm pretty much against it. I just don't believe in that, but I came anyways, and I wasn't yelling and pooping and hollering while you were talking just because I believe in the whole fact of, you know, you guys have something to say, y'all have something to share, so you should be able to share it on this public university. But with that being said,
thank you.
I do have a question about your honest opinion about all the diversity and the inclusion and the globalization and the commercialism and the ideals that, you know, the system is putting in our head. Do you think all of that is just going to simply go away because you and other people who think like you think that white people should just be at the top of it all? Like, is that just going to go away someday?
I don't really want to be at the top of it all. I don't want to be at the top of this. That would be like being on the top of a pyramid scheme that's about to collapse. That's probably the last thing I want, to be honest. There are a lot of white people who think, oh, well, you know, I'll be the ultimate, you know, HR director of diversity. This is how I'm gonna climb up the corporate ladder, by embracing diversity. I hate those people.
But you're not those people. They're gonna continue to be put out into the
business. Yeah, but you know, at the end of the day, those people who wanna be in charge of diversity, they're ultimately just a bunch of weak, moronic, fat idiots. Like, and you know, no one cares about those people, those whites who want to be the managers of diversity, who love the world we're entering. No, at the end of the day, those people are just total losers. I don't care about them. So they're gonna lose. They lose at everything. They don't have any. They don't have any will. They don't have any ideals. So who cares? They're lame whites.
What's your opinion?
That is. I didn't hear a question, but that's okay. Thank you. Okay, can we just say this? You don't have to preface every question with "I disagree with you." Just break. Ask the question.
Didn't you say during this talk that you had that the world of individual is dead? That was one thing you said, yes. Okay. 100K debt working at the gap. Talking about working at the gap, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. It's harder for, I can hear you, something about some race getting getting harder in life. Collectivist rights, and I'm getting the vibe that corporations are overall evil, correct? Or if you, maybe I misunderstood you.
Sure, yeah. What's your question?
Okay, so you said something about capitalism being terrible, correct?
You know,
that's the vibe.
I'll just go with it. If that's your vibe, that's fine. What is your question?
Okay, so if with all of these things, and you want a collectivist society of whether it's a white nationalist where it's all white people in one, you know, Africans in another, whatever, that's fine. Well, it's not fine. But
question.
I'm getting there, buddy. I'm getting there. Just hold on. I know this is a lot of information. Just wait. So how exactly? Are you any different from the SJW Antifa who want, I understand, hold on, you're sitting up here like, I know. So how are you any
How am I different from the SJW? I don't have blue hair.
No, well, obviously.
Yes. How much from the Antifa?
How are you?
A shower.
Okay, but ideologically, how are you any different when you're saying the identity over everything else? How are you any different? Whatever it says, whether it's, oh, well, I'm a...
Okay, I get your question. I'll answer it briefly. I am a collectivist. Absolutely.
But how is that different from the communist?
Individualism is for fags. A collective that has a hierarchy, that has a sense of camaraderie, is going to destroy a bunch of little individuals that it will gobble up. There is another great phrase, another great truth that Sam has also bestowed upon me, and that is, the strength of the wolf is the pack.
the strength of the pack is the wolf. It's not an either or. I can understand who I am as a person because I'm part of a greater family and I'm part of a greater story. That's where I get meaning. I don't get meaning from being some disembodied individual floating in the ether. And let's move on. User. Bernie. Hey, I agreed with a lot of things Bernie said, to be honest.
Good. Thank you for coming.
He's a fucking socialist, dude. I'm like, fuck!
Let him speak.
A little low spot, please. I'm from UAB. I study nationalism and world politics. I thought white nationalism was a very interesting alt-right movement. I think that the U.S. is far too young in itself to have created a shared history. I go more from Anderson's book, Imagine Communities.
I've read it.
I figured you did. So I think we've failed to create a nation state currently. We're kind of hashing that out for ourselves, picking and choosing our histories. So I've had kind of a difficult time with the alt-right being so new. So where are you borrowing your history from creating the imagined community that Anderson was so describing his book?
Well, that's it.
I want to characterize
that's a huge question, and I would probably have to write it.
Why do you think I came all this way to ask you this?
Okay.
No one else would answer me.
I know, but as opposed to talking for another hour, let me just answer it in a... Let me take part of it and answer that. One thing that Benedict Anderson talks about is this sense of nationalism that we're all reading the same newspaper. And there was actually something new that was brought with technology that, you know, we all watch the nightly news at 5 p.m. And we're all doing it. It's a collective experience, even if you do it alone. And that is a source of nation building, no doubt. I would say that what is happening in 21st century America is a profound and radical fragmentation. We aren't all watching the news at 5, we're tweeting 140 characters. And no doubt we are experiencing a tremendous fragmentation. And the question really, and the idea of America as a national community, I mean, give me a break at this point. We like to talk about that, we like to go listen to a presidential inaugural and say that we're all Americans. That's not what's happening. That's not the trajectory. The trajectory is towards fragmentation. And the alt-right is really fundamentally about putting Humpty Dumpty back together again. And we're all coming from this. I was born in Massachusetts, I grew up in Dallas, Texas. I don't come from some, you know, deep-rooted community of bonding and idea. I think we're all wanderers, we're all searchers. And what the alt-right is an identity movement, is that search for something bigger and greater than ourselves. White identity, this is something that everyone, all sorts of races, all seven genders, have all been engaging this.
I think there's five.
Okay. We're all in a way engaging in this, but there's one identity that's considered immoral, if not illegal, and that is white identity, and that's what the alt-right is fundamentally about. It is a kind of post-national movement, as we've known these nations. It's something bigger. It's something that's evolving and forming, and that's why it's so exciting.
Much smaller one, since you mentioned post-nationalism. I've been around the world, a few different countries, and I'm also noting this trend that people are beginning to less identify themselves with their countries, their names. They're no longer saying I'm Chinese necessarily, or I'm German necessarily. They are starting, they'll say, well, yes, I am German, or yes, I am Chinese, but I really identify this way, more so through religious ideology. So would you say, so would you say we're somewhat, this is a reaction to us as a human race moving post-nation state?
Yes, I do. I mean, this is a much bigger question. I think, look, I thought what Trump represented was a miracle. I actually explicitly said that this kind of thing can't happen anymore. Trump called upon these populist nationalist energies that I thought were dead, but they were actually dormant. But at the end of the day, Trump is just a stop on this train. Use that Trump train metaphor. He's just one stop. Because everyone knew that when he said make America great again, that was something that only resonated with white people. Maybe a few exceptions. Liberals are right, actually. It was an implicitly white nationalist movement.
Implicit.
I ultimately don't want white people to say, oh, well, I'm an American. I'm a real American. I want them to say, I am white. And that is...
thank you so much for answering my question.
That is post-national as we've understood it, and is radical. I would actually, seriously speaking, if you want to talk more about this, we can, but we might get off on some, like, book-length discussion.
I mean, if you're around, if you're coming to Birmingham, have coffee with me.
I will do that, sir, yes.
I read all kinds of communo anarchist stuff, but it's really ambiguous, it's weird, so. But I'm sure we'll have some interesting discussions.
Definitely. I will seriously talk to you, just contact me. Thank you.
I'm a Polish American, and the last time your shit kicked off, my people suffered for your love. So, not interested in a repeat of that. You can't run from your history. You can't run from the history of your movement. Remember
history like you.
White supremacy.
You have Nazis up front! Stop running up front!
Alright, so your argument is that I am literally Hitler.
You're carrying on that
music. Not really. You know, it's kind of... The fact that I'm actually... I absolutely... I absolutely respect ethnic identity and regional identity. I think that's part of who we are. It's just natural. It's part of this concentric circle of identity. But the fact that I'm not clearly a German supremacist, that I went to invade Poland, might be, I don't know, a tip-off that I'm not literally Hitler, but... It's the same movement. Okay. You speak in slogans. Dude, you're speaking in slogans. It's just not that interesting.
Not slogans. It's coherent. You can't just say that anyone is arguing against you. Speak in slogans.
You've grown tiresome.
They're not going to fall for that.
You have to let them speak.
That was me. Dude, you're just kind of boring. You're just boring. Okay, you. I'm sorry.
I just want to know about.
I didn't hear what you just said.
Oh, no, it wasn't for you. It was for the young lady from the Amber Snapchat.
Yeah.
But, anyways,
okay.
How are white people?
What's Snapchat?
Right? I'm asking the question, so we're going to listen. Please tell me how about you kiss my ass? How about that? Anyway, I go to the gym, honey. I go to the gym. Maybe that's over your ass. Anyway, like I said, y'all are gonna be quiet. No, my question is, how are
first question rather briefly. I would never deny that black Americans, that Africans have been oppressed, that they have experienced pain that I don't know. And I actually said that quite explicitly in my speech. I can't understand where you're coming from. And that's actually part of it. The fact is, in terms of white people, there is no question systematic discrimination against white people at all levels of society. That begins at affirmative action and it does not end there. Kind of hard to work together when you're joking about punching me and yeah. But look, I think there are some genuine people who truly do want to work together, and I actually think that we can work together in certain things. But there is this brick wall of working together. And that is that we have an identity. You have an identity. You're part of a story that I can't understand. And I'm part of a story that you can't understand. We are fundamentally different. And that's what makes the world beautiful. I don't want to turn everyone into just some individual. I want you to have your history. I want you to have your meaning. That's true diversity. That's what makes the world beautiful. But part of what makes the world beautiful is whites understanding who we are, what makes us special. Oh, all right. Is the mic gone? What happened to the mic?
I got it. No. We'll wait until we're all finished. All right. I have the simplest question. Am I white enough? You looking at me right now. Am I white enough for this whole... Exactly! What am I talking about? What the hell am I talking about? Am I white enough? Are you looking at me like I'm white enough?
You want me to answer this question?
Yeah, go ahead. Actually,
you do look white to me.
I do. I know. And I'm actually half white. Yeah, half my family's in Iran, though. They have the hijabs, you know. I know. Am I still white
Persian?
Enough? Am I
yeah,
still
you're like
white
whiter than I am.
I am still white enough.
It's kind of a funny question.
How is that?
I'm trying to ask you. I'm just saying you're white.
Whiteness in.
Who else do you ask that question? What other kind of people do you ask that question?
Do you ask black people that question?
Oh,
do you
yeah.
ask black people, are you black enough?
I thought
you
were
asking you. I'm asking you. For whom you doubt their identity, to whom you ask this question that's meant to disassemble and break apart their identity. Who else do you ask that kind of question to?
I actually ask everybody what they
really? Okay, give me an example.
Give me an example
of another race of people that you ask that kind of question to.
Black!
Okay, I'll go do it right now. Go do it right now. Ask a black person in this room, what is black enough? Ask them, what is black enough right now? Do it. I can't hear exactly what's going on. Did you ask him what's black?
I'm trying to see where it cuts off. Where does the white cut off and where does the color?
Well, okay, well, I will answer that when you ask that same question of black people.
She just asked.
There are black people in this room you can ask right now. What was the answer?
Ain't no such thing as black enough.
Alright, so we'll go with that. Ain't no such thing as white enough.
Good evening. Right. I want to preface this by saying I came in not even knowing who you are, not knowing anything about anything you stand for, and so my entire introduction to you was here tonight, and I found a couple of things kind of strange. First, I want to ask, do you believe in evolution? And have you read Guns, Germs, and Steel? No, I'm serious.
Yes,
I believe in evolution.
Okay.
Have I read Jared Diamond's Gun, Germs, and Steel?
Yes.
Many years ago. Kind of a dumb book.
No, what I want to
have you read Richard Lynn?
No, sir. But my question is, Africa. We stayed in Africa.
What?
Asia. No, I'm talking
all right,
about.
Sir, stop.
If we were playing a game of Risk and we ended up owning all of Asia, do you think we would have ended up being as prolific as we are now? What? Do you think
you
we
just
would,
said?
Do you think? Do you think whites would be as great as you say whites are if instead of starting in Europe, we lived in North America, or in Africa, or in Asia? If Europe was owned by the land...
I see what you're saying. Okay.
Started
this is basically a kind of like geographic, your geographic determinism of Jared Diamond, where there's all these special qualities to Europe that we were able to domesticate, crops and animals and so on, and that's what made us great. I feel, yes, this is a chicken and egg question, and there is no question that, I mean, first of all, let me back up a little bit. The fact that we didn't evolve in Asia means that we are who we are. I mean, there's this question of environmentalism versus genetics or racialism. In some ways, that shouldn't be a division. We are who we are because we evolved in a certain environment. We took on certain characters. I am who I am. I have blue eyes precisely because my ancestors evolved in a Nordic climate. So that whole division between genetics and environment just collapses. I don't know if that answers your question, but like, so you're saying, no, I don't think there's some, like, it's not like this is the movie Prometheus and like the white race was dropped here by aliens and we could have been anywhere else. No, I obviously don't believe that, no.
I say, do you believe that that whites would still be as great as whites are if they had lived anywhere else?
No, because we wouldn't be who we are. We evolved in a certain climate and under certain conditions. I mean, the essence of evolution, Darwinian evolution, if I were to sum it up in a sentence, it's that the gene pool is plastic to the environment. So we are who we are because we have this history, we have this experience. So no, you can't, it's just this fallacy that you can pick up a race and place it somewhere else. Now, we are in a totally different world. We have reached a singularity where natural selection is actually not operative. So therefore, I believe if you put whites on the moon or on Mars or so on, it would actually take on our character and take on our being because we've passed through this process.
I have a second question. So you were talking about football.
Yeah.
There's this person we've never known, we've never seen before, probably will never see again, and we cheer for him whenever he crosses the touchdown. What makes us less connected to him than Romans that died 2,000 years ago?
Because you're part of their family. You are literally their ancestors. That's what connects you to them.
But they're 2,000 miles across an ocean, but this man that is on the field grew up 100 miles away in the same time period. So how are we less connected to him?
Look, I think geography, your question just seemed to be about geography and ancestry. Ancestry trumps geography. That's my answer to every question you're going to ask.
Thank you.
Thank you. Who is this
one? Hello. Richard, thanks for coming to Auburn University, and you're bringing a friendly question this time. It's a question not just for you, but also for everyone who's went to Auburn like I did. First question. Should Florida State's quarterback, Jameis Winston, and Heisman Trophy winner, have been allowed to play in the national championship and defeat Auburn? That's my first question. And the second question is...
No.
Okay. Do you have any hope that Auburn will be able to win the national championship if our football players keep getting shot in this city and kicked off the football team every summer? Thank you.
No. You know, there's something, I don't want to express any northern superiority because I do love the South. But there is one thing. I have a degree from the University of Chicago, and there actually is one thing very special about that university. They saw where all this was going. The first Heisman Trophy winner, whose name I'm forgetting at the moment, actually went to the University of Chicago. They had a, believe it or not, they had an stellar football program. When I actually attended, I was in my early to mid-20s, and I would go look at a practice, and I'd be kind of like, well, I could actually play for this team, and that's kind of an insult to the team. But they realized where this was going, and they got out. And they were a Division II or Division III school. The fact is, you know, I wanna watch white people play football. I don't care if the game suffers or something. We don't get to see this, you know, some guy who runs a 4.040. I don't care. I want to watch a sport that has some connection to who I am.
You're not interested in the drama of who gets shot.
No, I try to avoid reading.
It's a really big deal because it can be like a.
It can really change the, yeah, it can really change the bowls, yes. Hi.
So earlier tonight you stated that you do agree that blacks have been oppressed over the course of history.
Yes.
You also claimed that you do see that whites were in the wrong in slavery and putting Indians on reservations. However, you've also...
Putting them on reservations was probably the nicest thing we ever did.
Okay, my next point. You've also called for peaceful ethnic cleansing. Peaceful.
I actually have not called for that to be.
Interviews. And then also
no, I haven't. No, I used the term peaceful ethnic cleansing actually in a speech, and I was describing the Paris Peace Conference of 1919.
Fully ethnically cleansed.
Okay,
also,
well, let me answer that, and then you can ask your next one. I did not call for peaceful ethnic cleansing. I was describing the Paris Peace Conference of 1919, which is actually an example of peaceful ethnic cleansing. After the First World War, this terrible event, a brothers' war that ultimately destroyed our civilization, far more than the World War II, to be honest, there was a nation-building experiment that took place in Paris in 1919. They knew old nations were reborn, Poland being an example, a state that did not exist, but a nation that's a people that did exist. New nations like Yugoslavia were created out of whole cloth in a way. That was an example of nation building, and yes, that was an example of peaceful ethnic cleansing. People, that was defined by nationality and ethnicity and religion, and yes, the map was redrawn. What happened in the Soviet Union is also an example of that. They were actually a kind of nation building experiment where they would give peoples a national poet or something like that. Ukraine is an example of a, you know, synthetic nation, to be honest.
So on your alt-right website, when you read the essay titled, Is Black Genocide Right? And it said, and I quote, instead of asking how we can make reparations for slavery, colonialism, and apartheid, or how can we equalize academic scores and incomes, you should instead be asking questions like, does human civilization actually need the black race? Is black genocide right? And what is the best way and easiest way to dispose of them? So my last question is how you can stand up there and claim that it is easier to be black because of a stronger sense of ethnic identity and a room full of African-American peers, African-American police officers standing out there protecting you when you have things like that written on your mind.
That piece was not actually at alt-right.com, that was at Alternative Right. It was written by Colin Liddell. He was making a rhetorical point that I don't know what to say. I mean, take it up with him. It's not...
I just think you're racist, and you think that the separation... Okay, I sat through your...
All right, you get one more question, but you're kind of boring me, to be honest.
Okay, well, I sat through your speech, so...
What?
I sat through your talk. Let me finish. You said that the separation between blacks and whites is what makes this country beautiful. So you're essentially saying that the racial division in our country makes it beautiful? I don't understand that.
I didn't really say that. What I said was... Look. I want there to be difference in the world. I want Africa to be African. but I also want Europe to be European. I actually want Native Americans is what, it's a PC word, Indians, American Indians. I want them to become themselves. I don't want them to become vulgar parodies of white people. And that's what they are. And I'm not saying that to insult them. There are many, many American Indians have supported me, actually, in controversies I've been involved in. I don't want them to become vulgar parodies of white people, where they become poor, drunk white people because of the things that we've done to them. I want them to truly become themselves. I want there to be difference in the world. I do think that's what makes the world beautiful. The ethnic racial strife that we see in this country does not make it beautiful, no doubt. But that is an expression why we ultimately need different countries. We need to go our own way in life.
I'm white and I'm proud and I'm a libertarian, I'm proud of that too. But whenever I tell someone I'm a libertarian, I like to describe it as I want the government to be smaller, lower taxes and all that. And I feel like you're not really saying that much about that, you're really focusing a lot on race. I don't really understand why you're focusing so much on race instead of
talking about taxes because I don't want to put people to sleep.
But I feel like it's a bigger issue, and you're trying, I don't know, kind of dirtying libertarianism with a bunch of race talk.
I'm not dirtying libertarianism. You guys are boring all on your own. Yeah, fuck libertarianism. High taxes, socialism, big government forever.
That's fine. Yeah, so the government sent you so you would rally against...
It's that guy in charity.
Rally against free speech? Is that what you're trying to do? Get people to rally against free speech?
Dude, I'm not a libertarian.
Okay,
what's your
fine.
Point?
I am.
I've never claimed...
Everyone should be libertarians, right?
Yeah. Go to the Mises Institute. Yeah. You guys can masturbate about gold coins.
Hello, Richard.
Hi.
Quick question. I would like to know your feelings on the... Because I feel like it's a pretty big issue, right? I mean, racism defined as... I mean, I feel like racism should be defined as prejudice, discrimination, or antagonization based on, you know, race, period. But, you know, in the past couple of years, there's been this big inflection of the...
I see what you're saying. Okay.
Institutional racism. I feel like you could... You know, if you focus on that a little bit more, you can get your message across a little bit better, maybe. I have one or two more questions.
What?
Alright.
Okay. Yeah, sure.
Fine.
So you're talking about how racism went from being like hatred or animosity directed from any individual of any race towards an individual of any other race, right?
Yes,
or
exactly.
Whatever, right? From this structural oppression that people of color face that white people don't.
Yes.
Exactly. That's anti-whiteness. Straight up. That's intellectual anti-whiteness. And ultimately, that is going to be used for violence, to justify violence against white people. And it already is. When you see these Antifa out there, South Africa is a good example, and when you see the Antifa hordes out there that will just attack us just for coming to speak here, that's an example of these people are completely incited by this bullshit intellectual crap that is meant to single us out as a uniquely evil people. And frankly, it's just anti-whiteness, that's what I'm... And if any of you are in a class and your professors pull this shit, call them on being anti-white, and they will not know what to say to you, because they have no answer to this.
One more. All right, so throughout your speech and the Q&A, I heard you say a couple of times, just a couple of quotes here, you know, you said we as humans, you know, we will create the world around us in our image, and you might have been referring to white humans, I'm not sure. You also said, you know, somebody said, you replied to somebody, I'm going to speak truthful. You also said, I am who I am. You bring up a lot about
this. It's kind of weird where college girls will wear a t-shirt that's so long that you don't know if they're wearing anything underneath it. That's a new trend. I kind of feel old. Uh-oh, she's back.
No.
No.
You're the one that should be embarrassed for your
friend. I mean, whatever. Yeah, okay.
Just, you hit on the truth and truthfulness a lot. All I wanted to know, Richard, was, you know, what do you define as true or truth?
What's true?
That's deep, man. Okay, next.
Hey, Richard.
Hey.
Good to see you, man.
Good to see you, man.
Thanks for doing what you do for us. I appreciate that. I want to know what influenced our movement.
The guy's a plant, dude.
And is the theory of Eurasianism a threat in the near future to our race?
Okay, this is a very big question. This is a reference to Alexander Dugin and the fourth political theory, and I actually have a little bit of hesitation answering it because I feel like we might get way off into some place where no one understands what I'm talking about.
I understand.
Okay, I think a key aspect of Dugin, and I would encourage people to Google him, be critical of him, of course, but learn about him, is that there are three major ideologies of the 20th century. There is fascism, there is communism, there is liberalism. Liberalism was triumphant in 1989, 1991, and in effect, we are all trapped in this end of history logic of liberalism, of basically the individual as a subject of history. I think the fact that Dugin is just simply raising these questions is a really positive thing, and I'm glad he's there doing it. In terms of, is Eurasianism a threat? Is there a kind of Slavic and Asian bloc that would ultimately be a geopolitical threat to the white race? That is certainly possible. I just hesitate a little bit about getting into this. It's going to be a bit arcane for people. I would say that East-West division of the Cold War, of Catholicism and Orthodoxy and so on, it is ultimately two heads of the same equal, and that is ultimately the Roman Empire, and that is ultimately a common culture. So I am certainly far more pro-Slavic. I'm a pro-Slavic person in the way I think about geopolitics, but I really don't want to, I'm not trying to shut you down, I just don't want to get in these arcane matters. I think we might be kind of way over people's heads. Okay, thank you.
Richard, thanks for coming out. I have one question for you. You said in an interview on NPR with Kelly McEvers, illegal immigration is not nearly as damaging as legal immigration.
Correct.
Legal immigration, they're here to stay. Their children are here and so on. Your ex-wife is a Russian-American and you have a child together. Please explain that.
She's not my ex-wife.
Or you're separated, right?
No.
Okay, well, the things I said, so you were separated, whatever. You're still together.
Yes.
She's Russian-American.
Yes.
And you have a child together.
Yes.
Did her family come here legally or illegally?
They did come here legally, yes.
So you're saying she's a big problem and you have a kid together?
No, because she's white.
You said immigration. It was white. You said immigration. You didn't
look, when I'm referring to the legal immigration question, they're not coming from Europe, they're not sending their best. The legal immigration question is a racial question because they aren't coming from Europe. Legal immigration is, in my opinion, far more demographically damaging than illegals. Because illegals, whatever you want to say about them, they very often go home. They very often come here and don't really integrate and change the culture. The mass non-white legal immigration is far more damaging demographically. But in terms, I don't want all white people, all Europeans, to come to the United States. I do want other nations to be intact. But yes, immigration is not a problem when it's white people. Legal and illegal immigration is a problem when it's non-white people. So it's pretty simple.
You'd probably specify it then.
Okay, I just did.
Hello, Richard.
Hi.
First, I want to thank you for speaking out against the Syrian bombings.
Thank you.
With Trump. I wish that we could see this sort of protest for warmongers like John McCain or Marco Rubio. Rubio.
So funny that all these Antifa, where are they when it comes to the war? Why aren't they protesting the war? They seem to be protesting people who are anti-war. I don't get it. It's almost like they're tools of the military-industrial complex. I don't get it. I don't know.
It's very interesting. I'm also glad that we have identified in the question and answer that you're not quite literally Hitler, but maybe Stalin.
Stalin. Literally Stalin.
I don't want to go back to beat that horse, but I kind of want to go back to the football. Because I think it's actually very interesting as far as the identitarian perspective. You know, I'm actually a Georgia Bulldog fan by birth, so it's kind of a hostile audience for me too. But you know, I grew up, you know, my family wasn't particularly religious, but we grew up, we spent every single Saturday watching Georgia Bulldogs.
Right.
And it always ended in pain and misery, so that's either here or there. But you know, so that is itself part of my family's story. And that is an aspect I think that you'll see throughout the South. That, you know, the family time, you know, this, you know, right now, maybe it's absurd to the outside or whatever, that's what it is. But that's part of a Southerner's family tradition. Now, I understand that you're born in Massachusetts, so, you know, as a Yankee, you know, it's a little bit different. But, you know, isn't there something to be said there? Like, isn't this obsession with race, you know, there's nothing wrong with taking pride in your heritage. Again, I take tremendous pride in being a Southerner. But isn't the obsession with race itself, especially considering the historical definitions and all that, you know, all that parallel things, you know, isn't race itself and obsessing on that, you know, kind of bullshit? I mean, isn't the real interest
in cultural
homogeneity, social
justice? Look, I get what you're saying, and I would be wrong to deny that there isn't some identitarian quality to football. It's about family, watching it together. It is about a sport, a beautiful expression of the human form at some level. So I get it, and I actually try to acknowledge those things, even though I do demand the banning of college football. But yes, I get it, and I just think this is somewhat of the sickness or the tragedy of white identity, is that we do define ourselves by these things. But I'm just acknowledging this tragedy. But I'm not denying that you have an identity that is to some degree based around watching.
But again, your whole point is being part of a story, though. And the story of a Southerner is very different than an American, you know, a Northerner, very different than a Texan, very different than a German, than an Italian.
Yes.
I mean, you know, isn't this whole focus on trying to homogenize this entire thing actually decreasing the uniqueness of our heritage?
You know, the idea that the alt-right or identitarians are the ones like homogenizing the white race is just a little bit odd. I mean, when I'm driving around the highway and everything looks like the place I just passed, everything looks the same, everything is maybe literally the same in terms of the same stores, the same truck stops, the same gross shit they're selling at these convenience stores. Like, that is what is homogenizing, not just the whites, but homogenizing the world. The idea that because I have racial pride that I'm destroying, you know, this regional culture is just, it's a bit much.
Thank you. So, it happened pretty recently, and I haven't seen your comment about it, you know, to the press or anything, so, but you recently gave, and I say it light, endorsement of Tulsi Gabbard on Twitter. I believe that was in response to
Trump's bombing in Syria, yes. Yeah. Or a missile strike in Syria, yes.
And I want to know, and I am aware that it's ironic coming from you that, you know, that you're praising the political decisions of a foreign-born, like, woman of color that practices Hindu, and, like, it's the complete opposite of Western white culture. But I want to know the differences between in another endless Jewish war and exhibiting the greatness of our race through colonialism and building societies that are reflecting of our own image.
Okay, look, in terms of the Tulsi Gabbard thing, I do...
That wasn't meant to be like a gotcha or anything. I genuinely want to hear your comment.
Right, I mean, I do admire Tulsi Gabbard. I think she's brave and I think she's wise on many issues. And so I'm not a dishonest person. When someone who might be very different from me, from someone who comes from a different perspective, says something that's truthful, someone who's trying to prevent World War III, of course I'm going to say, yes, go Tulsi, that's great. Look, I don't. I Trump was truly amazing for the alt-right. He was truly amazing for nationalism around the world. It's pretty remarkable. But look, if he's going to become George W. Bush 2.0, and that's what I thought then, I'm feeling better about him now. I think some people around him have explicitly said that's not what they're going to be about. Then I am. I'm back on the train. If he is going to truly pursue the things he promises in his campaign. But if he is going to go totally off course, then yes, I'll come up with another political strategy. It's pragmatism. And if someone who's non-white, who doesn't identify with the alt-right, says something true and wise, I'm going to give her a shout-out. That's all it is. Okay.
Can you explain the difference between attacking Syria and colonialism?
What? They're clearly different.
No, earlier it sounded like you were praising colonialism because you said that it reflected
colonialism and the Age of Conquest and so on was an expression certainly of European power. It was also a kind of tragic expression. I mean, in some ways the chickens have come home to roost in terms of colonialism. It's not something that I would hope that we would pursue in the future. So it's just a very complicated and kind of tragic story. So no, I don't just admire everything white people do. It's like, yay, white people, we just sent a missile into Syria, yay us. I mean, no, of course I'm not like that. Come on. All right, next.
Hi, my name is Joshua Mills, and if you can't tell, I happen to be biracial. So I'm black and white, so I have a pretty good understanding of what both sides of the coin is like. I just find it interesting how not, this is a general statement, but not general, you specifically, how a privileged white male such as yourself has come up with the idea that diversity is such a bad thing. When we live in a country that is known for being as diverse as possible, religion, race, everything. So my question is, without beating around the bush or giving a bad analogy or whatnot, could you give me a direct reason as to what is wrong with diversity?
What is wrong with diversity?
Yes.
It makes the world ugly. It makes the world lose all meaning. It's a way of bringing to an end a nation and a culture that was defined by white people. I could go on for hours about what's good about diversity. And what I mean by that is that it's not just diversity. We all love diversity in the sense of diverse viewpoints, or I want to learn about this new subject. That's all wonderful. That's not what diversity is. Diversity is affirmative action. It's about transforming white institutions into things that are unrecognizable. Diversity is about creating some new, non-racial, non-identitarian human beings that basically just parrot the same kind of liberal crap, but all have different skin color. Diversity is awful. There's nothing good about it. It is what is destroying the world. Okay, let's do this. I'm going to actually change what I said. Let's do a lightning round. So really quick, I'm going to be quick, and we're going to try to get through five people, but we have to be really quick, and I will do the same. You, go.
Does the state's power supersede, basic human liberties, do you think? Like in your ideal world?
Human liberties are only possible through the state, and so I think your question is not...
I'm a Southern Nationalist. My question is, it's become apparent to quite a few people that our own government is weaponizing leftist minorities, just people in general, against us, white Southerners and I suppose Northerners. But is it apparent that to you that there is a genocide against white people going on in this nation? And what do we do?
Yes, it's not a genocide in the way that we understand it from the history books. We're not being rounded up and put into camps or put into train cars or so on. It is first and foremost, obviously, a cultural and social and institutional genocide. That is clear. That is actually objectively true. That's what these institutions brag about, is we're going to have less white people, effectively. They might not use those words. But it is a genocide in a deeper way than that, in the sense that it's going to fundamentally transform the essence of the American nation, the essence of which was based on Europeans and Anglo-Saxons. So absolutely there is a genocide going on. What we're doing right now. It's a start.
How do you feel white people are more
oppressed? You know, oftentimes when I speak with African Americans, they'll say this line of, it benefits white women the most. And it's like, okay, maybe you can kind of get to that point where it benefits white women the most, but when institutions are directly, objectively trying to hire more African Americans, more non-whites, I think they might be benefiting from it. I just don't really buy this.
My name's Trevor. I'm from right around here. I'm a real fan of your work. I'm really glad I came here.
Thanks.
I just wanted to say on behalf of all my friends that came here with me today that you don't represent Auburn, and you should not have come here, and you should go fuck yourself.
All right, so our demographics need to be followed with every legal immigration in Europe.
Say that again.
Are demographics the only problem to legal immigration in Europe?
No, I mean, demographics is one measurement of a greater transformation that's going on. But this transformation is cultural and ideological and religious and all sorts of things.
Okay, so financial return, like the aspect of finance, is not an issue to you when it comes to immigration?
I would oppose immigration, mass immigration, even if someone could definitively prove to me that it would make everyone rich.
Have you read David Carr's American Boatlift?
But they can't, so it's not a problem.
American Boatlift by University of Houston, he cites the mass immigration of Cubans to the Miami labor market, and it shows native wages increase with the influx of, you could say, illegal.
You know, I answer that question. If that is true, I don't care.
Doesn't that prove somewhat that...
Even if that's true, I don't care. Alright, really quick, let's get through these. No more people come up. I'm gonna address everyone, but then we're gonna have to go through that, so no more questions after these. Go.
Alright. I'll try to move it. So, you often talked about evolution, and, well, yeah, race is not a biological entity for human species.
Alright, are golden retrievers, do they exist? What is a golden retriever? Does that exist?
Breed.
Exactly, race is a breed.
No, boom. It's not a different species. There's
yeah, no I didn't say it's a different species.
Alright. Well, you gave the tone that somehow...
Different dog breeds can interbreed.
Man, let me speak. You gave the tone that somehow whites are getting better because of everything they've been through evolution that... Well, that's just not true. You need way more time, evolutionarily speaking, for that to happen for any...
No. Golden retrievers. I'm sorry to harp on golden retrievers, but they were invented in the 20th century.
Richard.
Evolution can occur really fast.
Richard, I'm sorry, just kidding. Golden retrievers are created by artificial selection.
There is no Darwinian evolution. There is no fundamental difference between artificial and natural selection. Just a question of who's doing the selection.
Yeah,
the actual
and the
process
fact that
is the
one
same.
Is way, way more intense than the other.
Not necessarily.
Yes. Yes, that's why we're able to domesticate animals and crops in such a small period of time. All I'm saying is that...
Okay, what's your question?
Okay, all I'm saying is that there's no biological basis for you to claim that white people are better or will perform better or do anything better.
I'm not claiming that. I'm claiming that white people are unique. In the sense of people are unique, have you ever watched the Olympics? How many East Asians are in the 100-meter finals?
Let me finish.
Sorry, I don't want to dump on East Asians.
No, let me finish. My point is, if you're not having...
They created anime, but so, you know.
Okay. If you cannot use biology
they're officially
to determine
good.
What is the white...
Alright, I'm bored with you. Next.
No, I got bored for your talk. Now you're gonna listen.
I'm bored!
Dude, let me speak!
Okay, all right.
The point is, A culture in Europe is very, very diverse, and saying that you have an European culture as if it was the same thing is just like, it makes no sense. So what defines white culture besides the color of your skin if you cannot define it biologically and you cannot define it culturally?
Actually, Google defines it biologically. So sorry, take it up with Google, girlfriend. Next. Last one, and I'm out.
Nice to meet you, Richard.
Good to see you.
I watched an interview this week at Texas A&M, and I saw you earlier when you spoke on how that white tea, but I know you got your minions here, and they all have their inferiority complex, and they're going to follow you, but you all are going to let them talk.
We're doing it. You got the last question.
Okay. So I read a Willie Lynch letter, and he said in that letter that the things he created were spent on his axis for hundreds of thousands of years. I'm sure you're aware of that. When it comes to color barriers, white men raping black women to create color barriers between blacks. Bruh, the FBI conspired against the Black Panther Party with Cointel, bro, brother. You can turn around.
But I mean, almost literally, white men don't rape
the government. The government.
In terms of crime statistics and victim survey.
Are you going to let me talk? You and your little follower here, you and Robbie. Look, let me talk, bro. That's all I'm saying. Throughout history, the government has conspired to destroy things of diversity and unity. So you can't sit here and say that negative things are happening to white people when they happen to minorities since the inception of this country. Like, we all.
Right. Let's
No, bro.
Flow. Just flow right here. Start talking.
I am, bro. I shouldn't talk with them because they're following.
And don't interrupt them, just flow.
Alright, they don't have a mind.
I want to hear this. Go.
What I'm saying is, throughout American history, when it comes to the Willie Lynch letter, Jim Crow, COINTELPRO, different government programs that was used to destroy black unity because
I have no earthly idea what you're saying. Thank you, Auburn. We really appreciate it. Everyone, praise God.
Need a superiority complex. Need a superiority complex. Need a superiority complex.